So I'd like to welcome all of you to this member Q&A with the co-chairs of the American Academy's Commission on the Practice of Democratic Citizenship. Last month, the commission released its report, Our Common Purpose, Reinventing American Democracy for the 21st Century, a collection of 31 recommendations grouped across six strategies for achieving a more empowered citizenry, a more responsive and effective government, a more resilient civic culture, and a renewed sense of commitment to democracy and each other. The launch event was held online and featured the commission's co-chairs in conversation with Judy Woodruff and closing remarks from David Brooks. Over 1,000 people, including many of you from across the country, logged on to the event. Since its release in June, the report has been met with an overwhelmingly positive response. It's been viewed online over 60,000 times, and the report has been covered in various forms of media, from the opinion pages of the Washington Post to NPR, to the Ezra Klein Show. The Academy has seen unprecedented interest in this project, and we look forward to building on that momentum in the coming weeks, months, and years. I'm delighted to see so much interest in Our Common Purpose from our own members. We've structured today to be an opportunity for you to get your questions about the report answered by the Commission's co-chairs, Danielle Allen, Stephen Heintz, and Eric Liu. Let me introduce the three of them, and then we'll get started. Danielle Allen is a political theorist and director of the Edmund J. Safra Center for Ethics at Harvard University. She is a prolific writer whose focus is on democratic theory, political sociology, and the history of political thought. She was recently awarded the Kluge Humanities Prize for Achievement in the Study of Humanity from the Library of Congress. Danielle has been a member of the Academy since 2009. Stephen Heintz is the president of the Rockefeller Brothers Fund. His career, which also includes serving as founding president of the advocacy organization Demos and CEO of the East-West Institute, has been devoted to policy and nonprofit work that enhances the vitality of democracy and promotes more broadly shared prosperity. Stephen was elected a fellow of the Academy in 2013. Eric Liu is founder and CEO of Citizen University and director of the Aspen Institute's Citizenship and American Identity Program. He served in the White House and as a speechwriter and deputy domestic policy advisor in the Clinton administration and regularly contributes to the Atlantic magazine. From 2015 to 17, he served on the board of directors of the Corporation for National and Community Service. Eric was elected as a fellow of the American Academy earlier this year. We are so appreciative of their tireless work on this project. They met weekly for 2 years and for making themselves available today. I will now turn this over to the co-chairs for brief remarks before we open the floor for questions. Please remember to use the raise hand function to indicate you have a question. Stephen, would you like to start?
Well, sure, David. And thank you very much. And thank you all for joining us. It's great to see a number of friends and colleagues on the call, and we really appreciate all the support that you all have provided through the Academy for this project and for being with us this afternoon. So just a couple of minutes on a bit of the story here. The Academy staff began having conversations about the challenges in American democracy in 2017, recognizing that in many respects, we're living through a kind of critical period in our nation's history. And decided to create a commission that would examine the quality of our democracy from the perspective of the citizen, as opposed to focusing on it necessarily from the perspective of institutions. The data showed that Americans' trust in institutions was at all-time low, but also, even in some ways more worrisome, trust in each other has fallen to very low levels. And we know we are divided along partisan lines in a fairly bitter way. And there's a sense that the country is headed in the wrong direction. In fact, recent polling suggests that people who have that sentiment are now at the highest level in over 30 years. So the commission first met in the spring of 2018. And it's a very diverse and bipartisan group of outstanding leaders, 35 people from academia, civil society, politics, journalism, business, philanthropy, et cetera. Many of them members of the Academy, but not all. And they represent various views along the political spectrum. So this was diverse really in every point, every regard by design. And like most commissions, we collected and analyzed a lot of data. We scoured and studied the current literature in the field. We held expert consultations. We did a number of convenings. But we did something else that I think was probably among the most important features of this work, and that is that we set out to listen to Americans and to ask them questions about their own experience engaging in our current democracy. And so we had about 50 of these sessions across the country in all kinds of communities, large and small, with everybody from a group of Somali women refugees in Minneapolis to first-year cadets at the U.S. Naval Academy, conservative thought leaders in Jackson, Mississippi, retired people in California, students. So it was really an extraordinary experience of listening to Americans. And we heard themes that were repeated time and time again, themes of frustration, of disappointment, of a sense of belief that our democracy simply isn't working for average Americans, that it's rigged in some way against them, that their voice and their vote really don't matter. And at the same time, we also heard enormous hope for our democracy and a real interest in trying to be engaged in fixing the things that are wrong in our democracy. And we heard about projects at the community level all across this country where Americans are coming together across all kinds of difference to solve local problems and contribute to the common good. And I would say that this listening experience was probably the most important part of the commission's work in many, many respects. So when it came time to consider our recommendations with a very diverse and ideologically powerful individuals, we took inspiration from Benjamin Franklin, who at the end of the Constitutional Convention rose to say, "Thus I consent, sir, to this Constitution, because I expect no better, and because I am not sure that it is not the best. The opinions I have had of its errors, I sacrifice to the public good." And we asked the members of the commission to try to put aside their objections to one specific recommendation or another, and to look at this as a package, as a complete comprehensive plan, and try to find a way to endorse the entirety, as opposed to picking at the individual recommendations. And so we ended up with 31 recommendations, many of which I think are pretty bold. And in fact, the process of getting to consensus really only eliminated three or four ideas where we couldn't achieve sufficient consensus, which I think is a pretty remarkable achievement. And I think it's one of the great strengths of this body of work. So at this point, we are trying to move this forward in a big way. And we know that the pandemic has revealed the inadequacies of our current democracy in very vivid terms. And of course, the protests across the country after the killing of George Floyd demonstrate the civic energy that exists in America and the need to address the questions, the enduring questions of racial injustice. But we have come to see at the end of this work together, or at the end of this phase of the work, I should say, that de Tocqueville was right, writing in the early part of the 19th century when he said, "The greatness of America lies not in being more enlightened than any other nation, but rather in her ability to repair her faults." And this is an effort moving forward of repair and restoration, but it's also not a project of nostalgia. It's an effort to look into the future and the kinds of challenges we will face in this century and to build a resilient and inclusive democracy that works for all. So let me turn it now to Danielle, who will tell you a little bit more about our theory of change and how the various elements of the recommendations fit with each other. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Stephen, for sharing our journey. It has been a journey, 2 years of weekly meetings and so many remarkable engagements around the country with fellow commissioners. As Stephen said, there are 31 specific recommendations and they're bundled under 6 strategies, but the actual heart of the report is a case for renewed civic faith. Ultimately, all of our recommendations flow out of a specific theory of change, which is the fundamental thing that we hope people will take from the report. In our argument, our civil society, civic culture, and political institutions need to be linked together in a virtuous cycle. Neither on its own is necessary to sustain a healthy constitutional democracy or the kinds of commitments that we all need to democracy, to American constitutional democracy, and also to one another. As we heard stories around the country, we often heard people reporting on a vicious cycle, experiences of political institutions that left them feeling disempowered and therefore less willing to engage in civil society organizations, more experiencing a sense of alienation from fellow Americans and therefore also less ready to be trusting of their fellow Americans. It was a member of one of our listening sessions from Maine who literally said, I think that there's a vicious cycle that is defining our experience right now in this country. And so we sought in our report to replace that vicious cycle with institutions that left people feeling disempowered and alienated, which people experience as non-responsive, and civil society that people didn't want to participate in, and feelings of distrust or lack of sharing with other Americans. We want to replace that with a virtuous circle in which reforms to institutions, reinvestment in civil society structures that bridge across difference, and transformation of our civic culture would energize that civic faith, commitment to our institutions and to each other. The basic argument is that you can't have functional institutions if you don't have people who believe in them and are invested in them, and if they don't have organizations in which to collaborate with each other that connect them to their political institutions. Often in the space of civic engagement and participation, there can be a mode of responding to our current woes and crises that amounts to sort of an exhortation of people to sort of participate better, participate more, participate better. But the point is that our institutions have to be worthy of our participation. And that's the sense in which the two parts come together. So as we seek to re-inspire commitment and engagement with specific recommendations in the zone of culture, we also want to make sure that the institutions are worthy of that commitment and that our civil society organizations are functioning at a high level to connect people to one another and to those organizations. So as we thought about these three buckets, then civil society, institutions, and culture, we developed a strategy in each of those areas. Our argument is that we have to strengthen the capacity of civil society organizations by investing in infrastructure, social and civic infrastructure, and we use that word really intentionally, to help bridge divisions and develop better opportunities for people to experience and engage with political institutions. In the zone of culture, we argue that it is important to cultivate widely held commitments to core democratic values, norms, and institutions, and support motivation for participation in governance. This, we think, depends fundamentally on our ability to develop and achieve conviction around, broad conviction around, shared and inclusive civic narratives. The question of how we tell the story of our own history to ourselves is central to whether or not we can restore a broadly held civic faith. We also argue that we need to restore confidence in the legitimacy of our political institutions. And that means securing the integrity of representation by empowering voters, mitigating the distortions of money in politics, and protecting equality of voice. Those things taken together guarantee a Republican form of government for all, one of those constitutional guarantees that was a frame for our work. So across those three buckets, civil society, culture, political institutions, again, we have those 6 strategies, restoring commitment to constitutional democracy to one another in the cultural space, investing in bridging organizations in civil society, and a civic media ecosystem that supports common purpose, and then in the zone of institutions, of empowering voters, of building responsive institutions, and of ensuring equality of representation. And all 31 of the recommendations flow from those 6 strategies. But again, remember, the core is this virtuous circle linking legitimate and functioning institutions, the civil society that bridges, and a civic culture that supports civic faith. So with that conceptual core, a lot of specific policy recommendations to implement. We are, as Stephen said, really focused on 2026 as the point at which we'd like to see the full fruit of all our efforts realized. And Eric is going to carry the story forward with where we're going next.
Great. Thank you, Danielle. I just underscore again, this has been a remarkable process of co-creation and collaboration with us co-chairs, but also the Academy team, which I think everybody here knows is just stellar. I want to begin by saying that though we made a big deal of the release of this report, it was in the best academic sense a commencement. It was not the end of this process. It was really the launch of a next phase of this work. And our intention as a commission is that this report certainly not sit on the shelf, but in fact actually be the blueprint for reinvention of our democracy. And our commitment as a commission was to make substantial progress on each of our 31 recommendations by 2026, which is of course the nation's 250th anniversary. And we are in the first place very grateful to the Academy itself for actually committing to supporting the implementation and rollout of these recommendations over the coming months and years. And I wanted to say a word just about how we're gonna go about doing this. I think all the co-chairs have heard from many of you, many other fellows and members of the Academy, with ideas, with either a particular favorite recommendation or a general sense of captivation about the virtuous cycle that Danielle described, and now wanted to figure out, well, how can I plug in? How can I contribute? And in the first place, we have created an ever-expanding list of champions who have agreed to implement, to join us in implementing these recommendations. These champions run a wide gamut. Some of them are advocacy and reform organizations that are already committed to doing this work, whether it's on changing representation or national service or other aspects of our recommendation set. In other cases, the recommendations we've laid out actually call for and invite the creation of brand new initiatives, new collaborations, new ecosystems to put meat on the bones of some of the ideas in the report, but actually to take responsibility for being the vessel for action that we can actually build upon from the report. And so there's a real range of champions and organizations. And thus far, just in the last month and change since we released the report and final recommendations, we've already had 24 organizations nationwide sign on as champions and volunteer to work with us to actually, again, advance these recommendations. As you think about that work, I just want to name one thing and underscore what Stephen was saying at the outset about this remarkable context that we are living through right now. When we began this commission 2 years ago, of course, it was before a pandemic. It was before a lot of the incredible social change and upheaval that's been arising and part of the uprising that's emerged for racial justice. And so compared to even 6 months ago, there is a far heightened awareness among so many sectors of American life of our power, of our capacity, in fact, to reinvent long stagnant, long broken institutions, our capacity to revivify a sense of civic spirit and civic culture that had long seemed stagnant, and our capacity, in fact, to reanimate civil society organizations that had been laboring perhaps in the wilderness. And there's this sense of urgency that comes with the kind of crisis moment that we're in right now. And I think that's a good part of the reason why so many of these champions have agreed to sign on with a sense of real passion and commitment. As I say, these organizations will be launching new initiatives, building grassroots support, aligning their previous work and campaigns with the work of other allies to accelerate different reform proposals. And to give one example, those of you who've already had a chance to read the report know that there's a body of recommendations under what we call Strategy 6 to inspire a culture of commitment to American constitutional democracy and to one another. And one of the recommendations in that strategy, 6.4, is to increase public and private funding for media campaigns and grassroots narratives about how to revitalize constitutional democracy and encourage that commitment to constitutional democracy and one another. And to give you one specific example, the organization that I co-founded and run, Citizen University, has signed on as a champion to do this work. In part, that means doubling down on work we already do to build a culture of powerful, responsible citizenship by organizing catalysts from red and blue states, from urban and rural places, to teach them about civic power and cultivate in them a sense of civic character. But it also means we have signed on to join in a bunch of other collaborative endeavors that don't yet exist to create a flotilla of forces that are actually going to be part of, or maybe not flotilla, but rather Tocqueville's little platoons of democracy to mobilize now to actually revive the sense of civic faith and to actually reanimate or to create civic gatherings, civic rituals that are focused on the ethical, moral, and spiritual dimensions of our civic values. That's just one example of one organization championing one piece of our strategy and recommendation set, and you can multiply that by the dozens. I want to say here, in closing this out, that again, this is just the commencement. This is the beginning of our ongoing effort to build a broad, broad coalition across sectors, across regions, and across lines of ideology. I really want to emphasize this point. The commission itself was, I wouldn't say bipartisan, because that frame automatically validates the two-party frame of thinking about political and civic life. I would rather say it was cross-ideological. People from many different ideological standpoints, ranging from reform conservative, somewhat libertarian, to activist, liberal, and focused on racial justice or economic justice, came together in the way that Stephen described to come to consensus on these recommendations. And in that same spirit, we believe it is necessary as we go out there over the next 5-6 years to implement these recommendations to underscore that doing this work requires inviting people in who aren't already doing this work, number one. We got to build broad public support for these ideas across business, across academic institutions, private sector, faith organizations, but also to do so in a way that underscores that this is not a partisan cause. This is not a partisan political issue. This is not to advance one party's advantage or another, or even one ideological part of the spectrum's advantage or another. This is about that underlying foundational faith that if this system can be designed to work for all, then we can all have a fair shot at diving into that contest and engaging in arguments and participating in elections. And we don't know the outcomes of what those will be, but it's the fact of full participation that we're going for. And as a colleague and friend of mine, Martin Carcassonne from Colorado, often says, he's not a partisan in the traditional sense, but he's a partisan for democracy. And I suppose that's the only way in which I would want to contemplate speaking about partisanship here in this context. And so whatever issues you care about, whether it's climate change or healthcare, or rearranging our tax structure in the United States, or reforming education, or actually elevating public health and science, as you know, the chance to make real progress on these priorities it's very difficult to do that when structures are stagnant, when the system is unresponsive, when people have decided the game is rigged and check out, therefore making the game rigged. But we are in a signal moment of opportunity right now because all those things are up for grabs and all these opportunities have opened in a new way for us to show up and engage. And so we're so excited to have the Academy as an institution and have all of you as Academy members so interested in giving this report ongoing life and force so that by 2026, we can really feel that we've made real progress in establishing, defining, and executing a sense of common purpose in our civic life. You can find out more about the report, of course, on the website of the Academy, amacad.org /our common purpose. And the report itself is there, as well as video of many of the public engagements that we did all around the country. And so with that, let me close and let's open it up for questions and thoughts from all the participants in today's gathering. But again, thanks again to all of you for joining us. And thanks again to the Academy team for making this possible.
Yeah, thank you, Stephen, Danielle, Eric, for great comments. Please do raise your hands on the participant button down at the bottom if you'd like to ask a question or offer some thoughts. And let me also take the opportunity to thank, as you all have, the Academy staff who've done an extraordinary extraordinary job here. In particular, joining us today, Darshan Gu, who's the program director for American Institutions, involved from the very beginning of this project, a very key person. And I also wanted to take the opportunity to thank the Bechtel Foundation, Stephen Bechtel and his foundation for their support of the project from the very beginning. So I see a couple of hands raised, and please continue to raise your hands if you'd like to ask a question. Thomas Klein first.
Hello. I wonder if you have any advice. I haven't read the whole report. I've read part of it. I was really impressed with it. But the problem I have is recognizing the citizens that would still be comfortable with our president. And every time I hear a poll, there's always 35, 40% that are pleased, or 30% thinks the country is going in the right direction. And I can't conceive how a normal, rational human being could believe that. And I almost feel that anybody that after all this time still feels that way, how can I be happy with them voting and participating in a government if they can't see what's going on? And I'm wondering if the panel members have any suggestions. We're supposed to come together. We're supposed to respect each other's ideas. But I find it very difficult emotionally to do that, because I cannot conceive of a human being having any patience. Even my red state friends, I don't have too many Trump friends to talk to, but they always hated bullies, they hated braggarts, they hated narcissists, and yet they're embracing the person that has every single quality I despise, and he's running the country. And I just wonder how to get over that absolute disgust in order to be able to help move forward. Thanks.
Who wants to take that one on?
I'll just say a word about one piece of work that might be illuminating there. One of the things I mentioned, my organization, Citizen University, we just finished a cohort of what we call our civic seminary program, where we are training catalysts from around the United States to lead these gatherings that are a civic analog to a faith gathering called Civic Saturdays. And one part of the seminary experience, we do this exercise actually with a wall map, kind of like what's behind me here. Two maps of the United States, identical maps of the United States. Above one says hopes, above the other says fears. And then we asked all the seminarians, you know, give them a pile of post-it notes. We did this on Zoom, so we did this electronically last week. But we say, put as many hopes as you want in the hope map, put as many fears as you want in the fears map. Your hopes or fears for the State of the Union, about where we are as a country. Dozens of post-its get up there, and we talk them through. And after we've talked them through, and maybe if you do fears second, you feel kind of bummed out at the end of that. And then we go up there and we switch the labels over the maps. So the fears maps become the hope one, and the hope one becomes the fear one. And we ask them to actually sit with that a moment. And for many of them, it is just as jarring as Thomas, as you've expressed. Like, I can't conceive of what it would be like to have somebody who actively wants the things that I fear, or vice versa. And the more you sit with it, the more you realize, okay, if you put it out of the context of a particular president or a particular leader or even a particular moment, and ask simpler underlying questions about what is it that kind of is at the top of your priority stack in terms of values? Is it order? Is it belonging? Is it justice? You know, when you elevate these things and you realize that different people have different moral, ethical priorities for what it means to them to have a, quote, good life or a good society or a good country or a good president, you realize that the point here isn't to come to unanimity. The point is actually, in American life, to have better arguments about these visions. To come together does not mean to smush down argument and debate. It just means, in the you know, good traditions of the American Academy, to have less stupid arguments. And part of our job right now, as citizens, and certainly with this commission, is to equip more and more people with the capacity to see from the other side's worldview what are the things that, even if you find a particular person or position, to coin a term, deplorable, what are the reasons why, for fully valid ethical, moral reasons, they might be drawn to that? And that's that. It's that capacity for seeing and knowing another that, in the long run, is going to be foundational to our ability to sustain this democracy. Because, I may happen to agree with you, but you and I can't be, quote, right all the time. And the democracy depends on us being able and willing to switch those labels of those maps and step into the shoes of others over and over as a matter of practice.
So I might, if you don't mind, just jump in to connect the question to the theory of change that's at the center of the work. It matters that Trump was able to win on the basis of a plurality, both in the party and then in the country. And so that is one piece of our institutional system that is, rather than having a set of institutions that in themselves generate mediating and moderating functions that actually affect the choice set that people have, it's hard to actually read people's choices, right? That is precisely because our institutions deliver us extreme choices. We can't actually really read off what people's true commitments are from their choices. There's more that could be said about that, but so that's why we actually need institutions that do a better job of pulling moderate candidates in, not rewarding sort of the most extreme partisans in a primary and then re-rewarding them in a first-past-the-post election system. But we also need media ecosystems that set standards, help people curate information, but more importantly, link that curation of information to high-quality relational experiences. So in the work on the sort of recommendations we have around media, we have held up as an example, a key example, an entity in Lexington, Kentucky called Civics Lex, which has sort of rebuilt local media, filling a news desert, but connected media to in-person meetings where elected officials and constituents gather in small groups. So I'm going through these pieces because often we just sort of project onto voters something, you know, meanings about them. And the point is that we actually have to rebuild the connections among our institutions, the civil society organizations that connect people to each other in the media in order to open up the space for the work that Eric just described of civic empathy in effect. As I've done this work, I've been astonished to discover the sort of folks that I have had the chance to talk to, sort of Trump voters, for whom the way they think about Trump is basically that he's no more important than a pimple on a pig's behind. Okay, it's like the country was here before him, the country will be here after him. He's no more important than a pimple on a pig's behind. And that captures both, you know, their choice set, you know, they, in the context of their choice set, they figured they'd pick the thing that was gonna help them. They don't, there's a lot they don't like about it. Same way you don't really like get much pleasure from considering a pimple on a pig's behind. But nonetheless, given their choice set, that's where they were. So that's the point, I think, is about the virtuous cycle. You have to see the way in which our institutions and our civil society ecosystem interacts with our capacity to have human interactions with each other and even empathetic interactions. So hence the importance of reforming institutions, rebuilding, bridging civic society ecosystems, and doing the kind of work that Eric describes of digging deep on a cultural point.
Of course, this pimple is killing people right now.
Well, no, I know. I know. I do hear you.
Okay. Next, we have a question from Jenny Mansbridge. Jenny?
Yeah, I want to say that the aim and the methods and the execution of this report are absolutely inspiring. So I'm very glad you've done it, and I'm glad it's getting a really warm reception. My question is about your strategy for getting support from Republicans and conservatives for the report. Because although you brought on sort of what I might call kind of liberal Republicans like Norm Ornstein and David Brooks and so forth, some of the pieces like universal voting and felon voting are more progressive strategies. I'm not sure that would be an easy sell to the average Republican. So when you spoke of, Eric, when you spoke of the two dozen organizations that had jumped on board, were half of them conservative organizations or were they mostly progressive organizations? In other words, I just was wondering what your strategy was for reaching out and making this, the goal is reaching across ideologies. What are the methods for reaching across ideologies?
Jenny, thank you for that question. I think you're right. That does require intentional effort as a matter of strategy, as it required in pulling the commission together. And you know, I think about one of our commission members, Pete Peterson, who some of you may know, who is the dean of the Public Policy School at Pepperdine, University. And on Friday, I believe, he hosted a webinar with, I may mispronounce his last name, Ross Dutat from the New York Times, the columnist. And it was a fascinating conversation about what, debating the future of conservatism, but in particular, focusing on the question of what Pete calls a conservatism of connection, what Ross calls communitarian conservatism, in essence, a kind of conservatism that is meant to counter liberal individualistic, more libertarian notions of conservatism. And I name this for a couple of reasons. One, Pete was a very active part of the commission and continues to be a very active part of our outreach to conservative thinkers, conservative activists, and potential champions. But two, I think even the subject matter of that webinar on Friday was illuminating as a way for us indeed to reach conservative audiences. The spirit and the tenor of so much of our report and so many of the recommendations is not exactly left or right, but I probably would put it as more communitarian than libertarian. It is about our shared responsibility, about our common purpose, about our collective endeavors. And there's a way to get at that question that can animate both people from the left and the right. And there is actually, by my lights, some more interesting debate, discussion, and intellectual reckoning going on the right today about how to grapple with the costs of 40 plus years of a dominant hyper-individualistic liberalism, right? And so I think intellectually, we're trying to engage institutionally. One of our other commissioners, Yuval Levin, is at the American Enterprise Institute, as of course Norm Bornstein is. And so we're trying to work with partner organizations like that. Among the champions thus far, I'm not sure that you could split them along left or right. Many of them are nonpartisan organizations, but I certainly think we can be doing more to bring more right-leaning organizations into that fold.
Yeah, the only thing I would add, Jenny, and it is a really important question, which we've been spending quite a bit of time on, is that, you know, in the immediate period after the release of the report, the kind of groundswell that came rather naturally was from what we might call the kind of democracy reform community, which tends to be center or center left, if we want to place it on the spectrum of political ideology. But we have now started the more intentional work of embracing all of that support and reaching out quite specifically to organizations that we think can bring in more conservative leaders, more conservative thought, and more conservative support. And that is something that we're going to be doing into the fall. And we want to do it, and we invite Academy members who may have relationships with organizations of those types to really reach out to us and help us, because we will need some help. But we want to, for example, work with more specifically and explicitly with business groups and business leadership. And we want to work more explicitly and in more direct relationship with some of the faith communities. And we want to work with local civic groups that represent, you know, that more conservative part of American life. And it has to be work that is more intentional. And so that's what we're planning to do in the months ahead. We have, I would also add this, we have started the process of briefing members of Congress, and we have been briefing members from both parties and both chambers. And that's been fascinating because, of course, you know, every member will find the one recommendation they don't agree with and then test you on that. But we've had very, very good conversations with members of Congress, encouraging conversations. And we just got invited. In fact, Pete Peterson, the member of the commission that Eric just referred to, and I are going to do a briefing for 40 on a bipartisan basis, 40 members of Congress, organized by the Aspen Institute in September. So this is exactly the kind of work we are really trying to be strategic about, and we really welcome the input, the suggestions, and the help from members of the Academy.
Thank you. Next, Marilyn Brewer has a question.
Okay. I guess I do want to start by saying, first of all, that thank the Commission for the work they put into this and for deciding to go bold. This has been really, really inspiring at a time that my political activism was making me more and more despondent. This is probably the first document that has made me feel like there's some place we can be going instead of just putting out fires. So I thank you so much. And no doubt, as you say, not only can everybody who reads the report find the one thing they disagree with, you probably find the one thing that they wonder why it wasn't there. And I'm going to admit to saying that that happened to me when I was reading the section on strategy one, because there's a certain institutional disenfranchisement that's rather large that wasn't addressed, and that's statehood for the District of Columbia. And wondered whether or not the commission had talked about that as a component of 1.1. And if you did, is there a reason that it wasn't specifically mentioned as a form of increasing participation and engagement?
Thank you for that important question. I'll jump in on that one. So this connects actually to an earlier question somebody asked about, I think, HR1 and how the recommendations connect to that piece of democratic legislation, and it also relates to the conversations about the cross-ideological nature of the effort, and the question about to what degree does what we recommended align with sort of progressive positions. The way to see the bipartisan or cross-ideological nature of the work is to hold what we did up against HR1 and to see what's missing from it. Okay, so the things that are missing are things that was not possible to achieve bipartisan consensus around. Statehood for DC, statehood for Puerto Rico, the Electoral College, as such, would be those things. The increase in the size of the House has that we recommend by a minimum of 50 seats has the impact, for example, of shifting the balance in the Electoral College. That is a good example of where we got to by virtue of seeking a bipartisan approach to a solution to a problem. And so if you go through the report, the solutions, you know, they genuinely, even the ones that look progressive in some sense, are structured in a way that achieve bipartisan consensus. And the things that aren't there compared to HR1 are the things for which we could not find a way to any kind of bipartisan consensus.
Okay. I expected that, but it does say something about the process and how you kind of rose above some of those disagreements to at least agree on the higher order principles, which I'm very impressed with.
We wanted to find, I mean, just to add a little bit there, we wanted to find common ground, but we were also quite sensitive to the issue that we didn't want to turn kind of common ground into a sort of sacred cow that would mean we did nothing, right? So it was a very hard sort of project to set our ambitions high and also try to broaden the base of support for bold efforts.
It's common ground without the lowest common denominator.
Yes, exactly.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's the trick. Yeah. That is very much the trick.
Stephen, did you want to add something?
No, I just see a question in the chat from Howard Gardner that I would like to address at some point before we leave it.
I just actually sent the question in.
Yeah.
And basically, while I love the report and the writers, and I've listened to all the broadcasts, I'm perplexed that it's so entirely focused on the United States. And it would apply to somebody from outer space that there were no lessons to be learned from elsewhere. And yet, you know, as you look around the globe, you know, we're not doing too well in many dimensions. So I wonder whether it was a conscious decision to focus on the US, or whether if you had more space, you would have written about lessons from other parts of the world. What deliberations occurred on the American exceptionalism as opposed to global applicability aspects of democracy?
Yeah, well, thank you, Howard. And in fact, we did look to other parts of the world for lessons and incorporated some of them in the work and recommendations of the report. So for example, I think one of the bolder and perhaps even more controversial recommendations is an expectation of universal voting. And of course, the country where this has been practiced the longest and most effectively is Australia. And so we studied the experience of Australia as we debated this. And I would also say that the unusual emphasis that I believe this report puts on the problem of civic culture is also drawn from lessons from abroad, including my own personal experience. I spent 10 years living and working in Eastern Europe after the fall of the Berlin Wall. And I was working for an international organization that was trying to help the new democracies to become established and to develop the institutions and mechanisms after their years and decades of communism. And one of the lessons I took from that, my fellow commissioners have heard me articulate on a number of occasions, was that it's rather remarkable how quickly Poland and Hungary and Czechoslovakia and even some of the countries further east, like Ukraine, were able to adopt the institutions and procedures of democracy, the free and fair elections, the functioning parliaments, the independence of the judiciary, freedom of the press. All of those things happened in a very short period of time. But what those democracies are still lacking, and it shows in their current condition, is the nurturing of a democratic political culture, that the habits of the heart and the kinds of beliefs, the civic faith that we've talked about, which are so important for the foundations of those institutions to rest on something stable and powerful. And that's a huge lesson that we brought from studying what's happening abroad. We did ultimately make the decision that our mission was to focus on US democracy, in part because it has been viewed as exceptional, and we have claimed it as exceptional, and we might now think that one of the ways it's exceptional is in its deficits. And so restoring, or in fact reinventing, this democracy for a resilient and inclusive experience later in this century is a way of helping global democracy at a time that it desperately needs it.
We have, I see, two more questions. First, I'll ask Roberta Cooper-Ramo and then Bill Dove. So Roberta first.
I'm very grateful for this opportunity to have this discussion, and thanks to the fact that we're all getting used to Zoom, I hope that the Academy uses this way of interacting with the members more and more. First, let me say I'm not an academic. I'm a country lawyer from New Mexico, and I am deeply appreciative of the report and its focus on 2026. But I also believe that we are at a moment in our time where I will be deeply disappointed if the Academy doesn't focus on the now. I personally believe in American exceptionalism. It just doesn't happen to be this American culture. I believe in civic culture. Part of the breakdown I personally think that we're seeing right now, we see in the face of those people who somehow aren't willing to wear masks just to help save themselves and those around them. And I have in my hand the preamble to the American Constitution. But I'm really reminded of something that Rosie Abella, the justice from Canada, who's one of our members, said, has said many times, and that is, it's not what you stand for, it's what you stand up for. And I think what I am wondering right now is, if you look back at the American Academy during the Civil War, what did we stand up for then? Because I think right now, a project about American democracy and making it vibrant, exceptional, and important for every person could not be more important. But if we don't now have an answer to a culture that would be revolted by voter suppression, for example, that would be revolted by a culture in which flat out lies are allowed to be part of the civic discourse, then I'm not sure what we as an academy really are for. And I would hope that our founders, I think often of Ben Franklin in particular, but I really do wonder if right now we don't have an obligation to at least speak out in some meaningful way, not to one another and not to all of these organizations, not because those things aren't important, but to the American people. Thank you.
Thank you for a very thoughtful comment, Roberta.
I just wanted to offer a thought. First of all, Roberta, as a country lawyer in New Mexico, I presume you are related to a another New Mexican with the last name Cooper Ramo, Joshua.
Yes, indeed. He's our son, and I know him quite well.
Yeah, I know him not as well as you do, but he's a friend, and I'm an admirer of his, and so it's wonderful to be connected that way. I wanted to say, I mean, I think actually what you said in passing is itself a fascinating inquiry. I don't know the answer. And as a relatively new member of the Academy, I would like to know the answer. What did the Academy do during the Civil War? And how was the Academy? What posture did it take, or was it itself riven as so much of the country was? But I would just say, to build on what Stephen was saying in response to the earlier to Howard's question, a moment ago, there's more in here than meets the eye, I guess is part of what I would say, right? Just as there's more of a reckoning with global examples and global global interdependency of the good, the bad, and the ugly of democratic culture and authoritarian culture. We may not have named it in all cases in this report, but it's there. And I would say here too a lot of what we chose to say, not so much in the recommendation set, but both in the diagnosis of the problem and in the front section of the report, is naming the urgency of this moment and the fact that there is nothing automatically self-renewing about the kind of democratic republican culture that you're describing and that we're all cherishing, that the Academy was meant to itself sustain. There's nothing self-executing about that, and the fragility of it. You know, as I often put it, democracy works only if enough of us believe democracy works.
Right.
And that legitimacy is fleeting and fragile and evanescent, and it's disappearing as we speak. Right. And I think, we didn't name it in a way that was attached to actual politicians' names or this moment. But I think the rise of authoritarianism, as Danielle often cites, and I think is cited in the report, the fact that among younger generations, that among millennials, there's a declining commitment to the idea of democracy itself. Is something that we named, that we rang an alarm bell about, and the Academy has to say, hey, this is not okay. This is not just a matter of generational taste changing. We do have to stand for the exceptional potential of this form of self-government. And so I take your point quite to heart.
We're really running out of time, and I think we have question. To ask. To respond, there's very little in the Academy archives about slavery or the Civil War, and I think that's really unfortunate, and why I'm hoping that 100 years from now, when people look at what we're doing now, they will say that we were dealing with the major social issues of our time. But Bill Dove has one last question, and then we'll need to wind up. Bill?
Yes. Let me say, first of all, that I greatly appreciate what the American Academy is doing in making this open, in making a lot of his studies open access through the internet. And I greatly appreciate this Zoom meeting being even open beyond the members of the Academy. And that leads to the main point that I want to make. Daniel talked about vicious and virtuous circles and how does a system choose among them. And many of the members of the Academy are experimental biologists. They know about systems and how they work. And one of the important features that makes a decision is that of feedback. And so in much that I've been learning about this in reading the report and in listening today, I see that there needs to be partisanship for democracy, as Eric was putting it. And what one needs to see functioning in the system is some kind of feedback. So I think back to Greek tragedies and Greek drama and the importance of the chorus. And beyond the champions, I look for how our democracy can find a chorus. Here's an example from Wisconsin, where I'm a citizen in Wisconsin. Our ex-governor, Scott Walker, lost the most recent election. And he openly, the next day, gave the explanation for why he lost. He lost because there was a larger than expected voter turnout. Now, if you are a member of a chorus that believes in partisanship for democracy, you would immediately object to such an explanation for losing a democratic election, that there was a larger than expected voter turnout. This is clearly cynical and is an example of the system not working. So in virtuous versus vicious circles, what one asks from the outside is, hey, is the system working or not? And the feedback gives that response, and it can be nonpartisan.
That was beautifully said. And we all are hoping that everybody here will be a part of that chorus. We really hope that you'll carry the message, that you'll share the report with friends and acquaintances and your broad social networks. I think, Bill, what you said also was exactly what I was hoping to say to Roberta, which is that we had this fascinating conversation where we dug into the question of values. What values should the commission report stand for? Truthfulness was on the list, rule of law, decency, dignity, respect for human rights. And the amazing thing was that all of those really important values we had no trouble agreeing about across the ideological spectrum that we had gathered. There was one thing that we really struggled to figure out how to talk about, and that was the question of how to name the commitment we should all have to each other and to the country. All right, and so you've heard us talk a lot about love of country, commitment of all of us to each other, to constitutional democracy. We agree with you about the importance of affirming the other values. But the diagnosis we came to was pretty much actually the one Bill just articulated, that the thing that we are most sort of struggling with, where the trouble is the hardest, is the fact that we are not partisans for democracy. We're not partisans for our social whole. And in fact, support for the other values will be best advanced, in our view, by recovering our ability to activate that commitment to one another, that commitment to a healthy social whole. So it's, Roberta, not that we don't see the urgency of the values that you pointed to and the need for a statement about them, but that we came to see that the path to rebuilding those values lay through this very fraught area of the question of how we talk about our commitments to one another.
Thanks, Danielle. Stephen?
David, could I just maybe offer a note of some optimism at the end of this very good conversation, and again, picking up on Bill's notion of a chorus. As we were preparing the final report, we invited citizens who had participated in our listening sessions from all across the country to come to Cambridge. We covered their travel expenses, brought them to Cambridge for an evening and for a full day at the Academy, in order that we could give a bit of a report back to them on what we had heard from listening to them and their peers and fellow citizens, and to let them tell us more about what they were doing in their communities. And boy, what a powerful chorus. It was really extraordinary to hear those voices and to feel the power of democracy in that room, of people committed to each other, committed to the future of this country, committed to the idea of America. And I think that chorus is out there in the millions. And it is our job to tap into it, to give it hope, to give it energy, and to help it have a clear roadmap of things to do. And I think that's what this report really accomplishes. I think we may be on the verge of a very, very important period of reinvention that we can all really be excited about.
Eric, any last comment about what members can do?
Yeah, I just really want to emphasize that spirit of chorus. You know, we often put down the phrase preaching to the choir, right? And sure, if that means that you're just in an ideological or other kind of bubble, that's to be guarded against. But there is great utility, actually, in preaching to a choir in the sense of actually creating more choir masters. And I think, actually, the Greek tragic idea of the chorus might be the better variation on the idea that each one of you now can indeed open up a chorus, open up a conversation just like this one that doesn't require unanimity or consensus or shared starting points, but actually can just make contagious in the best sense, this form of reckoning with the good, the bad, and the ugly of our democracy, and with the opportunity and the need right now that we have to reinvent it, using again our report and the playbook and the strategies and recommendations within it as your starting point, as your object of study and your object of activation. We really invite and urge you to help us build broad-based support for this work, to emphasize again that it is cross-ideological and not partisan. In any way that the Academy can help you, help us in that endeavor, I know the entire team at the Academy is willing to help engage that way. So thanks to everybody for showing up today, and let's keep on showing up for our democracy.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you all for joining us today, for excellent questions that have been posed. And I'd like to give special thanks, of course, to Stephen, Eric, and Danielle for making yourselves available and your thoughtful answers. I'd like to thank everyone involved with the commission, members of the commission and staff for the great work they've done over the last several years, the time and energy that everyone has put into this project. So remember that you can see the full report and read more about our champions and upcoming events on the Academy website under Our Common Purpose. So thank you all for joining us, and stay well.